President, FBCCI, keynote presenter Mr. Asif Ibrahim, distinguished guests, fellow members of the Citizens Platform for SDGs, business leaders, friends from the media, ladies and gentlemen. On behalf of MCCI, I extend a hearty welcome to all of you and express my gratitude for joining us today. Sustainable Development Goals, SDGs, are the new global targets set by the UN, supported by the global community of leaders and researchers after the Millennium Development Goals, MDGs, came to an end in 2015, with mixed level of achievements. SDGs, with its broad 17 objectives, are crucial for all. These broad goals, such as zero hunger or no poverty, are acceptable universally. There are others which are particularly more pertinent for the business community and the private sector. Broad goals such as responsible consumption and production and industry innovation infrastructure are directly related with the processes and dynamics of industrial production and business activities. Yet, there are other broad objectives such as quality education and good health and well-being, which if achieved will benefit everyone, but more so the business enterprises by ensuring sustainable supply of qualified and healthy human capital. We are all aware that in the globalized business environment, the issues of social and environmental responsibility have become a reality these days. Various standards and international regulatory frameworks have already been developed, and failure to comply with these will put an enterprise out of the global supply chain very soon. These create a compulsion on the enterprises to adapt and comply with the new requirements and thus fulfill their responsibilities. At the same time, our business community is keen to learn more on the issue. The business community takes note that the increasingly important sustainable and green production systems are expected to become key factors in the near future in order to remain in the global market. Sustainable production and operations not only involve expensive infrastructure such as effluent treatment plants, but also calls for streamlining production procedures that prevent wastage and pollution while maintaining the same level of outputs with lesser carbon and water footprints. This requires technology transfer and capacity building and investment at the enterprise level. And at the national level, it requires fiscal and other incentives, policy guidelines, and regulatory framework. The business community in Bangladesh has taken up this issue seriously, and we remain engaged in providing support to the government in policy formulation and consultation. There is also a need for an awareness campaign on SDGs. At the same time, there should be research studies on cost-benefit analysis of adapting sustainable production and consumption for specific industrial sectors in Bangladesh. I urge the research institutions present here today to initiate such studies. We are delighted at the opportunity to have a keynote presentation today on the role of the private sector in implementing the SDGs. Additionally, we shall have the opportunity to listen to the deliberations of the Honorable State Minister for Finance and Planning to learn about the government's views and preparations related to SDG. Last but not least, there are eminent researchers and distinguished business leaders and practitioners amongst us to share their views on the issues. With this, let me conclude here and thank you once again for your kind attention. The program for the rest of the morning will be some introductory remarks by Dr. Debapriya Bhattacharya, followed by the keynote presentation by Mr. Asif Ibrahim, and then approximately from 10:40 till about 12, now let's say about 12:20, we'll have the open discussion, after which we will have the comments from the special guest, Mr. Mohammad Shafiul Islam, and then of course our close comments from our chief guest, the Honorable State Minister for Finance and Planning, Mr. Abdul Mannan MP, and then closing remarks from the chair, and then we should aim to finish up for lunch approximately at 12:45 to 12:55. That's the schedule for the day. Can I now hand over to Dr. Debapriya Bhattacharya, sir?
Thank you, Chair. A very good morning to all of you. I understand English will be the lingua franca over here. Yes. So let me continue on that. Colleagues, ladies and gentlemen, let me first join the Chair, the President of the MCCI, in welcoming all of you over here. It's a special privilege that the Honorable State Minister for Finance, Mr. Mannan, is here with us. He had been always a steadfast supporter of discussions which gives new ideas, so I compliment him for joining us over here today once again. We are also grateful to MCCI for partnering with the SDG platform. on this occasion. It's not coincidental because the member, the president of the MCCI is a member of the core group of the SDG platform, and another very eminent business leader, Mr. Asif Ibrahim, who will be presenting the keynote, is also a key person in the core group. So it's a unique partnership of the SDGs which we have forged in Bangladesh, building amongst the real, the some of the non-state actors, including the private sector, for-profit and not-for-profit, together, coming together, which will show the aspiration which we have in this regard. The aspiration comes from the fact that the realization during the MDGs that you may really generate a lot of government-related supplies, but if there is not adequate effective demand on the part of the citizens, then obviously this does not really work out very well quite often. And that is what we are here today on behalf of the SDG platform, to create that effective demand that the government and also other development agents in the country really delivers on the commitment which our Prime Minister has kindly signed up last year. And the issue is that if you look at the SDGs, which is quite different from the MDGs, that it is not only a government's business now to deliver on this. It demands a participation from the private sector and also other elements of the development agents in the country. So in that sense, building that partnership is very, very critical, not only on delivery, but also on transparency and monitoring, as well as accountability and review. So that brings us over here. I have no intention of preempting Asif Ibrahim's substantive speech, which will be coming soon. I just wanted to highlight one or two issues. The first issue is that role of private sector in implementing SDGs, on the one hand, is very obvious. On the other hand, it's very complex. Because it is obvious, because if you want to do away with hunger and generate income and investment, who else will do it other than the private sector in the future? So obviously, all the overwhelming part of the incremental investment will come from the private sector, and they are going to generate the work and their investment and employment income. It is, so in that sense, it is very obvious. But it is complex because till now, all the development frameworks which we have dealt with essentially had been a government-to-government framework. It did not really indicate how private sector will get engaged in the process and at what level and through what institutional mechanism. Are they going to really participate in the policy making in the consultative way, or they are only be involved only at the implementation in terms of the investment and others? So I think that is the point which we have. And this creates, this issue is quite pertinent in case of Bangladesh. And as I work across the world and I see that Bangladesh somehow lags behind in this particular area, in the sense, on the one hand, we have a very vibrant private sector in this country. It is really a matter of great pride that they have taken the country forward and really doing it as we move. But at the same time, we are not quite sure how the institutional mechanism for consulting the private sector has been set up in this country. We do see that the policy leaders in the cabinet and even above do consult the private sector, but it seems to be quite often, correct me if I am wrong, that is quite often it is episodic, thematic, and also not necessarily with adequate follow-up mechanism. So as we discuss the SDGs implementation in the future, and we want to extract the proper role, the full potential of the private sector, we would think of the creation of an adequate institutional mechanism through which the government is going to consult the private sector on a structured basis with full transparency and with adequate follow-up mechanism, and if possible, engage other stakeholders over there. Colleagues, I do not want to pursue this matter any further. I leave it to the business leader to deal with it. And my point I'm going to say that the private sector as envisaged in the SDGs are really multifaceted. It is obviously about the investment, income and growth and employment, but it is more than that. It is about creating decent work, creating the proper environment for the compliance and other issues for the workers. It is about also dealing with the violence against women in the workplace. It is about environmentally sustainable technological processes over there. It is also about having the not only corporate social responsibilities, but also about ethical productions and thereafter. So it's a very wholesome, program which is over there. And I'm pretty sure today morning that if there is any country in the world which is going to really address it in a very committed way, then it would be in Bangladesh. With that confidence and the partnership we have with MCCI and other business leaders, I conclude over here and wish you a very successful deliberation. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Bhattacharya. I'd now like to request the keynotes presenter today, Mr. Asif Ibrahim, who's vice chairman of the New Age Group and also a member of the Citizens Platform. Mr. Ibrahim will speak approximately for 25 minutes, so we hope to finish this up by 11:05. Ibrahim, Asif.
Thank you, Chair. The chief guest, the special guest, the convener of the platform, the discussants, and the distinguished business leaders, and ladies and gentlemen from the civil society, academia, my friends in the media, a very good morning to all of you. My presentation is obviously on the role of the private sector on implementing the Sustainable Development Goals, and we'll start off with the 17 Sustainable Development Goals in front. We've all heard about it, but just to recap what they are in the screen in front of you. The private sector basically cuts across SDG 12, SDG 8, and SDG 9, and as the convener had said, that it's basically a transformative journey from the Millennium Development Goal onward to the Sustainable Development Goals. And in today's presentation, we will talk about a little bit of that transformation. We will in detail talk about the role of the private sector. And what we'll do is do a situation analysis of the SDG 12 targets with our national plan, which is the 7th five-year plan. And then we will cut across some of the areas that intermingle, especially emphasizing on 12, 8, and 9. We'll talk about the existing policies that we have in the government and some of the projects that we're doing together with donor communities and the private sector chambers and associations. We'll talk about the resources and challenges. And finally, we'll have some food for thought. And obviously, I look forward to the engaging discussion afterwards. We clearly know that we've had some success in the MDGs. Bangladesh has been lauded in the international arena for that. We have been able to address the issue of the child mortality rate. We have been able to address the issue of attaining gender parity at primary and secondary education. And also in terms of overall poverty reduction, we've gained, we've had some achievements which can be patted in the back. However, the difference between the MDGs and SDGs is that the SDGs have been developed using a bottoms-up approach after several rounds of consultation with industry leaders, with academia, with civil society, with labor groups and others. So it's slightly different in that manner, and that the overall view of the entire gamut of spectrum has been covered here. The role of the private sector for implementing SDGs first was discussed in a bigger platform in the Rio Plus 20 Earth Summit in 2012. That is where the need was felt to engage deeply and strategically with the private sector for implementing the SDGs, particularly from the perspective of financing it, because we all know that there is going to be a huge resources necessary to implement these very broad goals. And the 2030 agenda, if it needs to be fulfilled, there has to be financial commitment from the private sector along with the government. Now we come into SDG 12, which talks about responsible consumption and production. Sustainable consumption and production is about promoting resource and energy efficiency. It's about sustainable infrastructure and providing access to basic services like green and decent jobs and a better quality of life for all. achieving economic growth and sustainable development would require that we urgently reduce our ecological footprint by changing the way we produce and consume goods and resources, particularly in the industries that we have, which tend to use resources like water, because we obviously need to be more focused in terms of ensuring that we do protect the environment. Yes, we'll talk about the investment later, because that is the primary point of concern for the private sector, investment as well as the cost of the capital. Those will come later. The efficient management of our shared natural resources is also very important. The way we dispose of toxic waste and pollutants, I had just mentioned that. And all these highlighted points have increased responsibilities on us, the private sector, manifold, to be more responsible for the use of resource that is available on the earth. And the government is in the process of preparing a strategy aligning the national policies with the sustainable development goals, and we are very encouraged to hear that. Now, we have done a bit of a comparison of the Sustainable Development 12 goals with the 7th Five-Year Plan. The 12.1 of the SDG 12 target talks about implementing a 10-year framework of programs on sustainable consumption and production. I note that the 7th Five-Year Plan targets really do not deal with this issue of this 10-year framework. Perhaps in our next national plan, we can look into it and try to incorporate some of these measures in the 8th FYP. In 12.2, it talks about by 2030 achieve the sustainable management and efficient use of natural resources. The 7th Five-Year Plan mentions that capacity development on resource accounting and natural resource management has to be considered. 12.3, it says half per capita global food waste at the retail and consumer levels and reduce food losses. This really hasn't been addressed in our 7th Five-Year Plan, but however, correct me if I'm wrong, maybe the convener would be able to correct me, that this is mainly a goal that's targeted towards the developed nations first. Perhaps the LDCs and the developing countries will follow it later. By 12.4 talks about achieving the environmentally sound management of chemicals in all wastes throughout their life cycle in accordance with agreed international frameworks. Our plan talks about encouraging different hazard-based contingency planning like chemical and technological hazards, road and water safety, nuclear and radiological risk, biological hazards, landslide, etc. Carrying on, 12.5 talks about substantially reducing waste generation. Our plan mentions designing and implementing plans on solid waste management in accordance with the 4R policy, which are reduce, reuse, recycle, and reclaim. 12.6 talks about encouraging companies, especially large and transnational companies, to adopt sustainable practices and to integrate sustainability information into their reporting cycle. Here, the 7th Five-Year Plan mentions that private sector needs to be more engaged. 12.7 is about public procurement, so it really doesn't deal with the private sector that much. 12.8 is support developing countries to strengthen their scientific and technological capacity. Our plan talks about supportive projects would need to be initiated. Private sector needs special support in this respect, which is very true. 12.8b talks about sustainable tourism that creates jobs and promotes local culture and products. Our plan mentions ecotourism promoted at least in 20 protected areas and ECAs. 12.8.c talks about rationalize inefficient fossil fuel subsidies that encourage wasteful consumption by removing market distortions. And our plan mentions primary energy subsidy will be kept at around 1% of GDP. Here you can clearly see that in a chart, in a pie, how interrelated SDG 12 goals is with the 7th Five-Year Plan. The 12.5 and 12C targets of 12 are partially overlapped with the 7th Five-Year targets. About 3% are fully overlapped. About 9.5% are partially overlapped. Equivalent to core 7th Five-Year FYP targets is about 7.1%. Other sectoral targets are about 37.3%, and we really do not have 20.7% of the goals. We do not have any targets in our 7th Five-Year Plan. We do have a National Sustainable Development Strategy for 2010 to 2021, which is the sectoral policy for achieving SDG 12. Two indicators where we have been able to come up with some data. So we've prepared a dashboard there on municipal solid waste, MSW. We surprisingly ranked 13 among 136 countries. This statistics was a bit of a surprise to me. However, we on the wastewater treated, we are 100 among 149 countries, so we really need to do a lot of improvement in that area as well. Now to SDG 8, which is promote sustained, inclusive and sustainable economic growth, full and productive employment and decent work for all. Here the SDG 8 talks about sustaining per capita income 7% for the LDCs, end child labor by 2025. It talks about labor rights. It talks about sustenance of per capita economic growth and productivity through diversification. Technological upgradation and innovation is extremely important. High value added labor intensive sectors. And it emphasizes the growth of micro and SME through access to finance. This is a big challenge for Bangladesh, particularly for the SMEs. We've been talking about it for many years. However, we need to address it significantly. It also talks about improving global resource efficiency in consumption and production progressively. And of course, education and training. SDG 9, which also cuts across some of the private sector interests and private sector issues and agendas, sustainable and resilient infrastructure, including regional and transborder infrastructure, talks about affordable and equitable access, inclusive and sustainable industrialization. These are new areas and topics that are coming up. Business continuity plan, in also we need to discuss in detail in terms of natural disaster. This would also come into this fora. SMEs to finance to improve their contribution to the global value chain, increased resource use efficiency and greater adoption of cleaner environmentally sound technologies, increase scientific research and upgrade the technological capacities. Now we come to the main agenda of the discussion, which is the private sector of Bangladesh and the role that we can play in terms of achieving SDGs and the challenges that we have in front of us, and the assistance and forwardness that's required from the government to make it possible. We all know that in the 7th 5-year plan, the total investment outlay is $407 billion, and the plan mentions that majority of that investment has to come from the private sector, which is $314 billion at approximately 77.3%, and the share of the public sector is 22.7%. The gross domestic investment as percentage of GDP would need to increase from the current level of 28.97% to 34.4%. The foreign direct investment is supposed to increase from $2.25 billion to $9.56 billion. Here, a lot of areas of improvement is indeed required. Maybe formation of the BIDA would do the job, but let's see. According to the Industrial Policy 2016 of Bangladesh, we have identified some high priority areas, sectors. Those are agriculture and food processing, information communication technology and software, ready-made garments, pharmaceuticals, leather and leather products, light engineering and jute goods. Before, we used to have 32 priority sectors, but we couldn't give priority to any one of them, so we have decided to reduce it to 7 higher priority sectors. But we feel that there is a severe need for sectoral strategy across these sectors. We even do not have proper employment figures across these thrust sectors. So we really need to focus on coming up with the correct statistics if we need to make any strategic plans for these sectors going forward in the future. The main target of National Sustainable Development Strategy 2010-2021 is to develop Bangladesh through scientific, social, economic, social development and environmental protection, which is section 1.4 of the Industrial Policy of 2015.
This is the source of this statistics is the National Labour Force Survey. As you can see, from 2003 to 2013, this is the employment situation, which is an area of SDG 8. Clearly, ready-made garment sector is the biggest employer, followed by the agro and food processing sector. We need to see significant increase in the other sectors: ICT, pharmaceuticals, leather and leather products. Our president, the current chair, represents that sector, so we clearly need to see more employment there, and then light engineering sector as well. The employment projection is very important, because in order to achieve SDGs, I think the clear and first and foremost issue that we need to address is how are we going to provide jobs to the millions of entrants into the job market every year in Bangladesh. Official statistics say that 3 million people come into the workforce in Bangladesh, and we need to create employment to them, and manufacturing sector is the only sector that can realistically take these people in and give them sustainable jobs. The share of manufacturing employment was to expand from 12% to 16% from 2010 to 2015, according to the 7th five-year plan. This indicates that the employment generation was expected to grow at an average rate of 6%. So based on that scenario, we have created a plan from 2013-2020, 2015-2020, 2025 and 2030, as far as based on 6% industrial employment growth annually. This is where we may be in the year 2030, with steel, ready-made garments being the biggest employer, followed by agro sector and then the other sectors. However, I do emphasize that we really seriously need to have national data of employment across all the sectors, so that we can set the targets accordingly. Industrial policy of 2016 talks a little bit about employment generation. According to section 2.2 of the industrial policy, it is the objective of the government to upgrade the contribution of human resources from 18% to 25% in 2021, which I feel is quite an ambitious target as well. Now, in order for the private sector to move forward, another very serious issue that we need to consider is the issue of climate change adaptation and disaster risk reduction in Bangladesh, because Bangladesh is a very much vulnerable for change risks that exist, and we are widely recognized to be one of the most climate vulnerable countries in the world. Climate change will exacerbate many of the current problems and natural hazards the country faces now. Increasing temperature will affect agriculture production, threatening the hard-earned food security the country now enjoys. Increasing sea level may permanently submerge large tracts of flat coastal land, forcing large-scale migration. It has been observed that more than 300 different chemical compounds are being discharged into the river by industries. I'm saying that, this has happened, throughout the industrialization history of this country. This has happened, but going forward, we need to be more careful, and we need to devise strategies so that we can protect these rivers as well, and we have to start thinking in that line. So if the current consumption and productive patterns remain the same, and with the rising population expected to reach 9.6 billion, we would really need to have three planets to sustain our way of life. So this is reality, and Bangladesh private sector will play a very significant role in this regard. I'm very confident in that. Also, the decisions of the COP21, which is unfortunately is really not very transparent. The SDGs are a global issue. Shared responsibilities have to be ensured. But the COP21 signed the Paris Agreement, but the responsibilities are not shared equally. The countries that signed the agreement pledged to reach global peaking of greenhouse gas emissions as soon as possible, without specific date. Specific measures for parties to decarbonize their economies is also not very clear. The Article 28 of the agreement has a provision of withdrawal without any sanction, and how poor countries or developing countries like Bangladesh will survive is a big question. Hence, we really need robust national policies and innovative solutions and closer public-private activities to address the issues of CAA and DRR in Bangladesh. And here I believe the government and the private sector can work in a much stronger manner of cooperation. The industrial policy and climate change is mentioned a little bit in the industrial policy. According to section 14.1, the industrial policy, it is imperative to create awareness among people about the harmful impact of the smoke and waste generated from industries. According to section 14.3, the government of Bangladesh will give necessary facilities to those industries which will implement the clean development mechanism, CDM. According to section 14.7 of the industrial policy 2016, government of Bangladesh encourages the private sector to develop green industries. However, we from the private sector feel that these policies lack objectivity. We really need clear guidelines and definable objects and definable targets and definable government subsidies or government incentives towards the private sector in achieving these targets. So we really need to work more towards that as well. It is basically a wish list, and in order to implement the wishes, more time-bound plan with finance is required. Some of the other policies and SDGs that we have is obviously the Vision 2021. It has addressed some areas and mentioned some goals like providing energy security for all, building sound infrastructure, managing urban challenges. The NSDS talks about environment, natural resource and disaster management. The 7th five-year plan in Chapter 8 covers sustainable development, environment and climate change. Now, how can we become play a much significant role for responsible production and consumption? We can obviously become efficient user of natural resources. Our companies can replace and recycle natural resources with waste and demolition waste, which is recycling. Recycled minerals and increased use of biofuels can be done. We can be more responsible in the management of natural resources. We can be more responsible in reducing food waste and food losses. We can achieve environmentally sound management of chemicals and wastes. We can step up efforts to establish eco-design programs and take-back systems that include proper control and monitoring of e-waste. Companies in Bangladesh can minimize release of harmful substances with wastewater and pollution of local water and farmland by limiting the use of hazardous chemicals during the production process. A lot of areas where we can make improvements and make efforts. We can also integrate sustainability information into the reporting cycle of companies. I think that can be a positive move. We can design and manufacture using of efficient, safe and more environment sound chemical processes and products. And we can of course take the advantage of using information technology in collection, handling and recycling of e-waste. Now talking about resources. Obviously, the resources for sustainable development goals will come from financial and non-financial sources. Government and international organizations, the donors would be source of the financial resources, while informative infrastructure, awareness build-up and policy will be the non-financial sources. According to the estimate in the final report by the Intergovernmental Committee of Experts on Sustainable Development Financing, achieving the SDGs in all countries would require additional global investment in the range of 5 trillion to 7 trillion per year up to the year 2030. According to an UNCTAD estimate, out of all these developing countries would need between 3.3 trillion and 4.5 trillion a year. And at current levels of public and private investment, there will be an annual financing gap of $2.5 trillion. So financing the SDGs is a huge challenge, which I'm sure will open up more discussions going forward. This is the resource status of MDGs Bangladesh scenario. Just to give a brief picture, I'm not going to go deep into it. But we did need foreign assistance of $5.0 to $3.3 billion per year under the baseline and high growth scenarios. Some of the significant projects and initiatives in Bangladesh, which I feel all of us must see, that are actually, which relates to some of the SDG goals, are the green brick project. It is a UNDP project. It removes barriers to the widespread adoption of energy-efficient brick kilns. We have the BRESL, barrier removal to the cost-effective development and implementation of energy standards and labeling, which is also a UNDP project, which falls under SDG 9. It talks about training module and capacity-building strategy for manufacturers. For refrigerators, we have the trees project, which is initiated by our garment manufacturers association BGMEA, which talks about resource efficiency and environmental sustainability. It deals with SDG 12. It talks about energy saving, natural gas saving, CO2 emission reducing, etc. We have a partnership for cleaner textile pack project, which is a holistic program helping factories identifying, implement cleaner production measures in water, energy and chemical use in the dye house, which deals with SDG 12. We have a sustainability and green growth working committee in Build, which is a public-private dialogue platform. Build was very closely working with PACT and an initiator of TSP. The activities of TSP will be subsumed, and sustainability and green growth working committee of Build will work more towards in the future to addressing the policy issues which deals with SDG 12, 9 and 8. Also, we have a promotion of social and environmental standards program, which is GIZ and Build will probably be a partner for the next phase. And we have a sustainable energy development program of GIZ, which is supported by the Ministry of Power, Water and Mineral Resources and German Federal Ministry for Economic Cooperation, which talks about developing the framework condition for promoting renewable energy and energy efficiency, which deals with SDG 12. We have the TSP, Textile Sustainability Platform. We have the, again, IFC has more involvement in the Partnership for Cleaner Textile Project. The impact of this program will be in three areas: implementing cleaner production practices, improving water resource management, investing in technologies that will significantly reduce water consumption and effluent. Okay, now some of the challenges that we see in the National Sustainability Development Goals, obviously, is the very high population of Bangladesh, the poverty and inequality that exists. We do have unplanned urbanization still. There are a lot of gaps between the different government agencies in terms of development. Energy security is still a bit of a challenge. Inefficient water resource management, natural disasters, and climate change. In general, these are the challenges that are there. Okay. As you can see there on the screen. Now some of the way outs, how we can go about addressing these issues. Information, so that a national action plan. I think a national action plan is very much important, aligning the SDG goals. All policies of the government should be coordinated and aligned in order to achieve the SDGs. A database of activities, projects being implemented. We need to have benchmarking of resource. Enforcement capacities need to be strengthened with and we must have more private sector awareness in where the chambers and associations we can play a much stronger role. We can have a private sector task force and utilization of public-private dialogue platforms for policy reforms. Of course, we need support from the donor organization, how best these can be availed and utilized. Unfortunately, the Green Climate Fund, the GCF, really we couldn't use it so far because of the complexities, but that could be an area where we can look into. Green financing policies of Bangladesh Bank need to be looked into in greater detail. Private sector need all related support. Bureaucratic mindset should be changed. It should be more supportive and friendly to private sector. Regulatory reform is the topmost requirement right now, and financing challenges are also very, very important. Well, you know, we have been doing some work, and this has been seen in global media. As you can see, Finance Minister mentioned in the Bangladesh Investment Summit that we are supposed to be a top investment destination. Then, you know, the Daily Star mentions we are breaking free from fossil fuels. Okay, now the private sector is ready to engage. We want to contribute, but we need government support. We need donor community support. We need to have funds made available to us at a very competitive rate so that we can make these necessary investments. Business is about profit. However,
we are open-minded. We will extend our hands of cooperation to the government and the civil society and the academia and the donor community if these conditions are met. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Mr. Asif Ibrahim, for an excellent and I'm sure very provocative presentation. It was extremely dense in terms of the information that is presented, and I'm sure that we will have a lot of discussion around it. I'd like to take this opportunity to introduce to you also members of the Citizens Platform. We have now with us also Ms. Shainanam and of course Dr. Mustafiz of CPD. On our side, we have Swatima also from the CPD, and I don't think any other core members have survived the traffic yet. I have a dual role here. I serve also on this platform, but I'm here in my capacity as a member of this chamber today. Thank you very much, Mr. Ibrahim. Before we go to our designated discussant, I think a couple of points just to start off maybe. The first was this, I think I want to thank Asif for raising the point that how private sector cannot do this alone and the need for engagement. Secondly, the enormous amounts of resources that will be needed if we have to actually move. I think we mentioned in the trillions of dollars, the estimate is from 3 trillion upwards. The role of the private sector is, of course, if I look at it, the goal 8. The full productive and decent work for all. And we all know that Bangladesh has been extremely successful in finding its own low-cost solutions. And Bangladesh has pioneered a lot of low-cost bottom-up solutions. So to make sure that Bangladesh does not lose its own sense of priorities as we look at all these, if I can say, maybe sometimes too many goals, and make sure we find our focus. So with that, I would like to now move to our designated discussants. The first designated discussant is the Managing Director and CEO of Green Delta Insurance. Needs no introduction, Ms. Farzana Chaudhary, ACII, and of course, the 2016 local SDG pioneer. Farzana, of course, is doing groundbreaking work on her own in her organization in SDG, and I'm sure we'll have a lot to say. Farzana, the floor is yours. Approximately 10 minutes, if possible. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. President, MCCI Nasim Manzur. Honorable Chief Guest, Mr. A Mannan, MP, Honorable State Minister for Finance and Planning. Honorable Special Guest, Mr. Shafiul Islam, Mohiuddin, First Vice President, Federation of Bangladesh, FBCCI. Mr. Debapriya Bhattacharya, Governor SDG Platform. Mr. Asif Ibrahim, Vice Chairman of the New Age Group and President Beard, and member of the Citizen Platform, and ladies and gentlemen, a very good morning. And I'm really thankful and I for inviting me to speak here. SDG is, you know, it's a kind of a buzzword nowadays, that what is SDG? Previously, we used to talk about MDG. And why, I mean, the SDG was adopted for ending poverty, fighting inequality, injustice, and tackling climate change by 2030, with a mission vision that no one to be left behind. And of course, today's discussion was focused on SDG 12, 8 and 9, that would actually lead towards poverty eradication, hunger and other goals, other 17 goals. Thank you, Asif Bhai, for your analytical representation and for insightful information, which has actually opened the eyes of the private sector. As you know, that the government has also taken a lot of initiative for the SDGs, and the development organization are working at DFID, GIZ, World Bank, IFC, WHO, and many. And of course, private sector is actually working, on the forefront for implementing this SDG. There are private sectors who are actually working on many innovative solutions without even knowing that these are actually leading towards the achievement of SDG. we're looking at the presentation, where we've mentioned that there is a need for the private sector to work with the government and also other multi-stakeholders, we need to have a committee which involves the government, which involves the development partners and the private sectors who are actually involved and who are in the process of implementing the SDGs. And before implementing the policy, there should be involvement of the private sector implementing the policy. And as Asif Bhai has mentioned, we need to have proper guidelines. So the structuring the guidelines, and of course the responsibilities of each stakeholders, the private sector should be involved. And after the implementation, there should be a review committee every 6 months. I mean, what are the outcomes of the projects, and of course, and the pilot projects that has been taken. There should be a review committee, and of course, learning by doing things, and then finalizing the policies should be, I would say, the starting point. The development partners should have the opportunities to work with the private sector directly, because we often see that the development partners are actually going through a government. And in the job employment opportunities, I think private sector has a tremendous role, where they should be incentivized, there should be tax holiday, and there should be subsidized rate for the energy rates and the discounted power. In this type of activities, the private sector should be encouraged to create more job opportunities, which will lead to poverty eradication and, of course, hunger. As we know that there are 10 economic zones which will be established. We are in the process of establishing, where our Honorable Prime Minister has actually launched. I mean, where the economic zones actually forces the private sector and the government to work together, and of course that will lead to achieving the 17 goals. I think Shahab Bhai is here, and you are also involved in establishing the economic zones. And there is a private-public partnership project which actually involves, and they're working on implementing the strategies. And I think this is a platform which will play a crucial role in achieving the SDG. So I think the economic zones, the policies, should be embedded, with those SDG goals, policies. Looking at the other SDG activities which are taking place in Bangladesh, like for instance Green Delta, we've been recognized by the UN recently for women economic security and empowerment for our implementation of our Nibedita, that is a comprehensive insurance scheme which provides trauma allowance for rape victims, acid victims, and those who are exposed to rape bullying. And it has a value added services. We'll be launching an apps which will lead to access to finance, access to information, access to law enforcement agencies, lifestyle partners, access to hospitals and trainings and counseling services. So which will actually create a platform for women to be more secured economically and also satisfying their health needs. So in this case, what we are facing, the finance is a crucial issue, because to scale up our product, our services in Bangladesh, insurance is a sector where it is I think from the policymakers to the normal people in Bangladesh and in the village, awareness is an issue. So for scaling up these services, we need support from the government in terms of policy implementation, and of course funds from the development organizations. Like in these apps, we are involving all the private sector, like banks, law enforcement agencies like elite force, but we need support from the police and the RAV, which also includes, we need permission from the ministry. So it's a really, you know, it's a very lengthy process. So, but we cannot wait for that. We have to start the process. So in this case, definitely the government has a facilitating role to help us. And of course, regarding the climate change, we have a product called the weather-based indexed insurance, which will help the farmers, you know, to be more secured. And of course, that would be a bundle product by the loans from the banks. So that will also, that needs more research. We need a more research and development in achieving the SDG goals. There should be a research and development wing who would be working continuously and of course analyzing and comparing the achievements and also the policies that are in place and the policies that are present presently exist in the government. There are in the education sector, the private sectors are working, I think, relentlessly. There are numbers of universities that are in, that are working in Bangladesh, which is helping our young generations to get more education. But we need more soft skill training, and of course, the work for the workers. I think there are many areas that can be, you know, worked out. Like the Prime Minister's office, they're working through 5,000 digital centers and helping, you know, the poorest of the poor sector to be included in the banking and the financial sector and in the financial inclusion. Now insurance is also included. So for the workers, there should be a separate banking channel, there should be more health benefits, the health insurance policies, and there should be less job attrition. If they have more you know, security in their job, there would be less attrition. For the gender equality, I think apart from our company, there are a number of chambers, a number of companies that are really working. And we need more partnership. Partnership not only among the private sector, but also multi-stakeholders, the financial institutions, the chamber bodies, and the NGOs, the banks, insurance companies, they should come under one umbrella and, you know, work together to create a one service platform for the customers. And for the health, I think there are a lot of pharmaceutical industry. They are selling drugs at a discounted rate. They are having medical campaign. The hospitals are having different initiatives for the poor and also for their employees, special packages. And the Ministry of Health has taken a lot of initiatives. The SSK project, where we are working with them, the Shastra Shuraka Kormoshuchi, which provides a universal healthcare. And they're also working in the waste management system as well. So to cater the need to improve the end-to-end process of the total healthcare system. So there is a need to work on this, and the private sector should have a crucial role. And of course, I think the policies should be there by the government to implement those goals. So in a nutshell, I think I could explain whatever you know, the private sector is doing. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Ms. Farzana Chaudhary, for, I think, a very good summing up, and also for being exactly on time. I have a reputation for being a little tough on this, so thank you. I'd like to now, before we go to the next discussion, just to summarize three things, because we have the privilege of having our Honorable Minister of State for Finance and Planning here. So, Farzana talked about research and the importance of research. I think it's very important that the governments policies, specifically budget proposals, also take into account and align some of this. We have in our chamber looked into why Bangladesh has such abysmal spending on R&D from the private sector. And I can tell you that our opinion is that there are no incentives for corporates to spend on R&D. To give you a fact, after the top 10 countries that spend on R&D as a percentage of GDP, India and Korea are in the top 10. And the rest of them are D8 countries. So that shows you what R&D can do for our economy. Both Korea and both India have spent and continue to outspend even China as a percentage of the GDP. So in our budgets and in our incentives, we see no incentives for corporates to spend on R&D. The second one, of course, that she talked about was the need to scale up finance and soft skills training. I think that was very, very important. That is also getting to be a critical. We are focusing too much, I think, at the bottom of the pyramid training. That's very important. Mid-management training continues to be a big challenge for the entire economy, not just for SDG implementation. So with that, I would now like to request our second designated discussant, Mr. Abul Qasim Khan, of course, who is better known as Shahzad, the past president of Dhaka Chamber of Commerce and Industry, and of course, a key member of the Khan Group. Shahzad, 10 minutes if possible, please.
Sure, thank you. Thank you, Nasim. Bismillah Rahman Rahim, Honorable State Minister for Finance and Planning, Government of Bangladesh. First Vice President of FBCCI, Mr. Nasim Manzur, President of MCCI, Dr. Debapriya Bhattacharya, Convenor SDG Platform, Mr. Asif Ibrahim, former President, DCCI, and today's keynote speaker. Ladies and gentlemen, Assalamu alaikum and a very good morning to you all. I would like to take this opportunity to thank Mr. Asif for his in-depth and detailed presentation on the role and the importance of private sector in the SDG goal. I had the privilege to go through this presentation earlier so I could better prepare my plan and thoughts for this today's presentation. Mr. Asif Ibrahim has covered all the major points in the issues under SDG 12. I will just limit my comments and feedback on the issues where I think further discussions are needed and also share some ideas under the SDG goals. The prime driver for SDG is the government. As the government sets the rule where industry and business operates. Given today's economic reality, the private sector participation is critical since private sector is a major driver in the economy across the world. However, it seems that the private sector consultation in the policy directions need to grow from the current levels. If the SDGs need to have meaningful achievements, increased participation of the private sector in policy planning must be undertaken so that the desired level are achieved under a collective participation and ownership. Just to add my comments on the presentation, under 12.7, which Asif presented, promote public procurement practices that are sustainable in accordance with national policy and priorities. Here in the presentation, Asif mentioned no target under plan, but I feel it is important to address this issue as resource allocation and resource utilization are key components in the sustainability issue. Therefore, this must be addressed as it affects our investment into the right infrastructure and services. Therefore, I think a target should be given to this goal. Under 12.8A, support developing countries to strengthen their scientific and technological capacity to move towards more sustainable pattern of consumption and production. I think Farzana did touch on the R&D aspect. I will just give my thoughts. There is no particular target in Bangladesh, which Mr. Nasim Manzur already mentioned, and which I feel that there needs to be a platform where industry and I think the universities need to come and talk, and that platform has to be incentivized by the government. And initially the creation of BUILD was based on the R&D concept that research and development needs to happen in Bangladesh, and Bangladesh must develop its research to move forward into the middle income and upper middle income country. So the concept of BUILD was initially set up on the R&D platform. On the reducing waste through recycling and reuse, slide 20, where Asif presented, where it proposes that pulp and paper industry can increase recycling rates and together with manufacturing develop solutions that lead to less wood fiber use on natural forest in Bangladesh. Here I would like to add that innovative and climate sustainable use of pulp and paper industry should be looked into, and I would like to add that pulp and paper from green jute, which was pioneered by Bangladesh Chemical Corporation, BCIC, and Cornerfully Paper Mills under the Industries Ministry in 1993 and 94, was a breakthrough discovery in the grassroots level in the discovery of pulp making for paper from green jute. But unfortunately, further research was not undertaken, but given today's sustainability agenda and climate issues, we must reopen the research of this breakthrough, which would help save millions of trees across the globe and ensure a proper ecosystem protection from Brazil to Bangladesh. And Bangladesh, being one of the largest growers, will not only benefit from this, but also would be adding real value to the jute growers with alternate source of revenue earning, and would have a domino effect across the rural economy. Number four, becoming efficient user of natural resources, where Asif mentioned in his slide 18. In the context of Bangladesh, I think the most valuable resource that we have is our land. However, land is limited due to its size, and other hand, because of Bangladesh's huge population. Therefore, sustainable development must take into account the use of land, given our projected income growth. Industrialization will not only eat up valuable land, but also limit the agricultural output. Therefore, proper planning of land and the best use plan must be undertaken seriously in a strategy direction. Therefore, zoning laws become necessary and very critical. I don't know if there is any policy currently under thought of the government, but I think there must be zoning laws. Therefore, land will become a major challenge for the development and the SDG challenge for Bangladesh. Although I believe that the SEZ will cater to this requirement in many ways, therefore sustainability of the special economic zones must be undertaken into serious consideration, as it will not only help accelerate growth, but create large employment for the economy, and moreover, help to limit unplanned industries across the potential agriculture land. Therefore, industrialization under the special economic zone should be a top policy priority for the government. I would also touch upon the SDG 11, particularly 11.3, which Asif did not cover, though it does not affect the private sector, but I think it does. But it says, by 2030, enhance inclusive and sustainable urbanization and capacity for participatory, integrated and sustainable human settlement planning and management in countries. Just to add some food for thought, and moreover, all are interlinked to the relation of sustainability issues under SDG. The goal related to sustainable city, where I think private sector role needs to take place side by side with the public sector. As per the DFID Vision Paper 2030, that by the year 2030, more than 80 million, and by the year 2050, more than 100 million Bangladeshis will be in the urban centers. Half of Bangladesh's population will be living in cities. Therefore, decentralization of Dhaka city is needed. Adequate and timely policies must be needed to offset the pressure of Dhaka city, and planned development of other cities need to shape up. Decentralization of Dhaka city from a policy and population standpoint will be one of the hardest and most critical SDG goals or challenges. We need to reduce the Dhaka-centric urbanization and create much-needed satellite towns around the megacities of Dhaka and Chittagong. And unfortunately, there are satellite towns already in place for planned development within the Dhaka-Chittagong corridor, for example, Feni, Kumila and other cities. Therefore, the best use of this corridor and its economic well-being is needed to create under a public-private planning mechanism. I'm not saying public-private partnership, I'm saying a further enhancement of this relationship, public-private planning mechanism. Initially developing the cities within the Dhaka-Chittagong corridor with immediate short-term to mid-term solution to this decentralization challenge. the population, it will broaden the growth prospects in the other cities. But the real question needed to address and the right policies must be in place. One, how does public-private partnership can achieve and attain the objective set under the decentralization program to reduce such urbanization pressure will be critical. How public policy programs can invite the or attract the private sector involvement and, or how public sector can incentivize the private sector businesses, it is very important. Priority programs such as tax breaks, incentives, subsidies and other business and personal levels need to be under a policy for the private sector. To develop investment, the required infrastructure from roads to schools to hospitals in the less developed, less attractive areas, including living in these areas. Such projects can be maximized under a PPP or any other model, but key investment deficits can be addressed if sustainable returns can be assured with the right policy support as mentioned under the incentive or tax break plan. The private sector will have to be supported in to invest in sustainable development in sectors where it is more difficult due to weak regulatory environment, perceived high risk of investment returns and investment returns, starting from renewable energy to schools to roads where the returns on investment is low. I think the public sector has to support if the SDG goals are to be met. Mr. Asif has rightly pointed out to the recommendations which I feel are very critical. The government will drive the SDGs since it is they who create the areas for business to operate. Therefore, sustainability of business also must be ensured as well. If business and private sector are real partners, is to create a real partnership in the successes of SDG, adequate policy reforms will be needed from trade to taxation, whereby business operates and contributes. Therefore, industry, trade and business reforms are also critical priorities for the participation of private sector under the SDG achievement plan. Mr. Sam Billa, the head of Economic Transformation and Trade Program at the European Center for Development Policy Management, who says in the Guardian newspaper dated 24/6/2016 interview, and I quote, "The important element for business is that their role has been recognized. They are not considered the bad guys anymore. The discourse has changed. Seeking to pay, make profit is not seen as incompatible to development." Thank you.
Thank you very much, Shazad, for an excellent summary and also, I think, some new food for thought. Just to summarize the importance of public procurement, it's interesting, you talked about innovation and sustainable and the importance of, sir, again, I would like to draw your attention to how policy can actually be contradictory. We've just heard about the jute industry and how paper and pulp can be used. The importance of acquiring technology and know-how to better use our resources and to upgrade productivity and move up the supply chain is critical for Bangladesh, whether it's diversification or moving into more value-added garment products, which of course Mohiuddin Bhai will tell us about. But let's see what your policy is telling us. The direct tax on technical know-how is increased year on year from 10% to 20%. If the know-how fees are more than 8% of tax, we are then taxed at a higher rate of tax. So effectively what the government is telling us, sir, correct me if I'm wrong, is don't get better know-how. Continue to use less know-how and use technology, because technology costs money. Now, technology providers charge money. So as Shehzad correctly said, if today there are excellent uses of bamboo for flooring, I know that the Ekikhan group has worked on it, and they can acquire technology from Japan, other, if they acquire the technology and the technology costs 20% more, it's not feasible, sir. So this is where I think policy is contradictory to some of the things that you also want to do, and these can be easily addressed in the budget, that why should technology and know-how be charged at a higher rate when we're moving towards better technology? I cannot see the logic for this. Thank you, Shehzad, for talking about sustainable use of land. We already know about this. I'm not going to talk about this. And Shehzad also proposed, I think, an interesting new idea about public-private planning mechanisms, not just public-private partnerships, but if we have to talk about Dhaka, once again, the cost of living, sir, in Dhaka is today is the same as Montreal. I repeat, the cost of living in Dhaka is the same as Montreal, but what is the quality of life? So if we want to attract even local talent to continue to work in Bangladesh, is becoming difficult. Foreign talent is getting more and more challenged. So if we don't fix Dhaka, it's going to be very hard to grow. So I think, thank you very much, Azad, for bringing that up. The floor is now open. We would request you to please identify yourselves briefly and make your comment or preferably question directed at a member of the presenter or the member of the panel or anybody in general. And if you could please limit yourself to about 5 minutes. Floor is open. Yes, sir, right in front.
Very good morning, everybody.
Very good morning, everybody. I first of all thanks to Mr. Debapriya Bhattacharya and also CPD for inviting me here and also include us as an associate member of the platform. I am Abdul Sattar Dulal. I am from Bangladesh Pratibandhi Kullan Shomiti and also the president of NATFO and also UN champion on disability rights. I very much, I also appreciate the speaker that Farzana Chowdhury mentioned that no one left behind. It is the basically update spirit of the SDG. MDG was not include many. That MDG was exclude many. So because of our work in international level, our dialogue, our participation, action, and SDG is updated and included a spirit that no one is the left out from anything, any sector, any development. So my point is, I want to first of all, I appreciate the government that UNCRPD, United Nations Convention on the Rights of Persons with Disability, is signed and ratified. And SDG also signed. And in line with that, government, with the our Honorable Prime Minister leadership and encouragement, the Disabled People's Rights and Protection Act 2013 is approved. And also there is some action plan and policy is take place in the country. Perception level of the people is in huge level, I want to say that. But the challenge for the SDG, Mr. Asif, the presenter, honorable presenter, was mentioned that I want to touch in that point. The challenge for the SDG I see is the one is the our country infrastructure. Our most of the infrastructure is not friendly for almost 40 to 50% people of the country. If you consider the child, with mother, want to go to the market with using the trolley, small, pushing the trolley, children sitting and go to the market, is very comfortable for a mother to go to the market. So that types of mother is not able to go out from home because of the baby is so small and there is a road and footpath is not appropriate for them. And also pregnant women, their workplace is not good in terms of the, because toilet, washroom are not friendly, there is no commode, no system, that much is in a different places. And including the disabled people also left out from these types of, even in this building, even in our road, our transport, our office, this infrastructure is the challenge for us to include the disabled people. So my point is I want to propose that to government should, and also private sector, I want to advocate for us because private sector need these people in market to buy things. You know, you want to make a business. So how, if you left out the 20% population from the country, means that your income is left out 20%. So you need to think in industry is appropriate for all people in the country, and government also need to think about that this 20% people should continue as a burden of the charity program of the government, or it is a good people, effective people to contribute in the tax level so that economic growth is increased in the country. So that is my last point is, please, I want to say that the especially I have opportunity here that the most of the leader here in from the private sector about the disabled people inclusion in the private sector. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Sattar. Yes, on the right hand side.
D.D. Ghoshal, I am representing Bombay State.
Could you please, we have someone here and then Mr. Ghoshal. Where is Mr. Ghoshal? Sorry, I think we have a request here and then Mr. Ghoshal, please. Sorry, just first here and then.
Thank you so much.
Yeah.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Sujala Pant. I'm the Deputy Country Director ad interim for UNDP Bangladesh, and it's a real pleasure to be here with such a panel of such experts and highly esteemed professionals and the State Minister of Finance as well. So first of all, my thanks for inviting us to this event. I'd like to make a couple of reflections based on the inputs that were provided this morning, which was really interesting for me because I think the private sector still remains somewhat of the other side for us. As someone mentioned, you know, we're very much used to working with our government partners, and we're very thankful for that partnership. But given the changes that we're seeing now, it's just not possible to continue working only with one type of partner, and the role of the private sector cannot be underestimated in this regard, particularly the SDGs. Yesterday I read an article in The Guardian which referred to a research about the role of private sector and their involvement and engagement on the SDGs. And out of the research, which covered about 250 companies worldwide, I think, the research found that over half of these companies are actually not really interested or have any intention of engaging on the SDG agenda. And when they do, it's on very specific goals, like goal 12, as Mr. Asif was talking about quite extensively, and a couple of others. And so this points to a large question, which I guess I would like to ask in this forum, since there are representatives from the private sector, is seeing the SDGs not as an add-on to your business, but a core part of your business, where the SDGs drive your investment decisions. Is that something that is possible? Is it something that's realistic? So that's, I think, an important question for us to consider. And if it is, then what do we as development partners, what does the government need to do to facilitate those decisions? Because at the end of the day, it is about incentives. As someone mentioned, business is about profit. But there's nothing to say that growth and sustainable development are mutually exclusive. I think the SDGs agenda is really showing us that the economic, the environmental, and social go together. It's just about finding that overlap that meets the interests of all the actors involved. And for this, you know, it's really about the enabling environment. As Dr. Bhattacharya mentioned in the beginning, it's not just about the investment decisions, but it's also about private sector having the right enabling environment to operate in, transparent policies, knowing that the taxes that you're paying will actually be used to the greater good of society. And I think that enabling environment, which is captured partly in SDG 16, is an important area of work that we can do as well. I'd then like to make a few points about the type of work we're doing at UNDP, some of which were mentioned in your slide. Then there are a few others, one of which is the partnership we have, of course, with Build, which is really our main interlocutor with government. And I know that we're working towards establishing a working committee on water usage. Again, as someone mentioned, the level of usage of water usage of government agencies versus others is apparently very imbalanced, and so, you know, discussions around that and how the private sector could also come in and play a role is something that we're working on. We're also working on awareness of the SDGs, but also inclusion of different stakeholders, particularly the youth. I think over 50% of Bangladesh's population is below the age of 30, and we know there are some very innovative young entrepreneurs, and we're working with them, you know, to develop various types of applications that can be used for disaster preparedness, for instance. Again, something that is at the cornerstone of development that is sustainable. We're also working, not so much here, but I would like to reflect on some work that we do across the region as UNDP regional office, is on collaborative research. We've done a lot of work on climate finance, governance and climate finance, where we want government public investment decisions to be informed by climate vulnerability. But you know, it's well and good to say that climate is an important factor in our decisions, but you need evidence to back up your whatever decision it is that you're taking. And so we're working with think tanks and the media to produce the type of data that is useful as a public investor. There's no reason why this can't be extended to the private sector. As you mentioned, research and development, producing data that is relevant and useful to the private sector for them to be able to take these right, these decisions that are also meeting social needs. And finally, I'd like to mention that we're currently working with the GED on the sustainable, the SDGs Monitoring and Evaluation Committee. And that is meant to be a multi-stakeholder platform. And it wouldn't be an ad hoc sort of meeting. It would be something regular that looks at the SDGs agenda comprehensively. And if we're expecting the private sector to play an increased role, then that committee is probably a really good platform to have that sustained, regular engagement on the overall agenda. So again, thank you very much for the opportunity, and it was a pleasure to be here today. Thanks.
Thank you. Thank you, Ms. Khande. Mr. Ghoshal, sir.
Thank you for inviting me. Gentlemen, I have very small comments and observations in these things. Before a few months, I have seen in newspaper, Metropolitan Chamber of Commerce asking to the government through press conference, whenever you make some policies or things, please talk with us, consult with us, or private government consultative management. But in practice, what we see in SDG, now anything we go for good, it turns into a bad things. Say, for example, our infrastructure is not at all compatible with the present growth of the economy. What we have done with recently with prime movers, we before implementing these policies, we could discuss with these stakeholders. What is it? 4 days we have lost. At least 1% of the economic benefit of the country has been lost through these things. So before implementing anything, policy making things, there must be some types of mechanism so that the policymakers consults with the stakeholders first and then go for some type of implementations. Then we are working with food, we are a food maker actually. For hunger, potato is a very good possibility for this country. And it is being wasted like anything. Opportunity is being lost. No research for alternatives. If we could use potato dal like North Bengals, at least 25% of food requirements could be solved through these things. This is my observations. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Yes.
Thank you. Assalamu alaikum. I am H. Mizal Kabir, former secretary, and I am working in the Dhaka Chamber as secretary general. Actually, I would like to mention here one thing that what UNDP deputy country director said correctly, that what we need to make everything sustainable, because MDG was not target for sustainability, it was for target some minimum goals, but now the sustainability comes in for play because of this. See, any development activities should be targeted for the welfare of the people, for the masses, for global people. So here we find that as a private sector people are investing, they know a need to be accountable, and as well as government is also accountable to the people. And for that accountability, we need how we can ensure the welfare of the people, and that too, private sector is a driving force for economy, and they're trying to make a profit as well. And they need a technology. What we already discussed here, that technology charge is very expensive. So I need, as a former secretary of the environment, I found that we have a scope for climate change, given a scope for this technology, green technology, to get in. Because in Bali, we talked about four pillars, four block, building blocks, and one of those was transfer of technology at the affordable cost to the developing countries and the vulnerable economies. So there we find that we have a scope left to have green technology from the developed economies for the benefit of the vulnerable countries. And in this case, I'd like to mention that IP and WTO regime should be tracked so that green technology can be given at a very affordable cost, because we know that if we go for this sort of energy efficient valve in Bangladesh, they're very expensive, but what was conventional one was very cheaper. But this technology should be made so that business people can employ and invest that, and the people can get it affordable price. That should be the technology transfer purpose. The second I would like to mention here, that one thing we're missing here, that accounting for sustainability should be very important. Everybody should be accountable. For that, I start my talk about here, that accounting for sustainability, even for the private sector and public sector, should be should have that data, how they can make it accounting for making things sustainable, growth and economic growth. And for that, I believe that we need some sort of, you know, inclusive that already came up. Inclusiveness, Mr. Dulal also said that inclusiveness is very important, and we believe that inclusiveness can be a boost for governance compliance, because we lack compliance in many sectors. So we need governance compliance, because we have got a lot of rules and regulations, everything there, but what we need, implementation. And for that implementation, we need SDGs is the first and foremost thing, and then inclusiveness. And there we believe that if we can ensure inclusive governance compliance, then I think implementation will be easier and cost effective, and our people welfare targeted. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Kabir. Mr. Sheikh Fazle Fahim from FBCCI.
Thank you, Mr. President. Thank you for inviting me. I'd like to share my experience. Recently, we had a tour from SAARC Chamber of Commerce and Industries to the United States, and we had the opportunity to meet different global stakeholders, including the UNIDO, State Department, World Bank IFC Group, World Bank Group IFC. And what our exchange and engagement has given us very positive hope in terms of cooperation between the stakeholders like UNDP as well. What we have learned from them, our visit, is that these foreign global stakeholders, they're international global stakeholders, they're looking into cooperation, they're open now to cooperation with the private sector as well. We have heard from Green Delta Managing Director and Shahzad Bhai as well, that R&D and capacity building cooperation, knowledge partnership, also financing, this kind of joint engagements, they're very much open to. We are working with UNIDO currently, with FBCCI, to bring in some of the protocols. We're examining how to adapt them, how to make them inclusive in our policy, and negotiate with the government in terms to inline the domestic policy with the SDG goals. So these are some of the works that we are doing, and most of the things we have heard here is encouraging, and we look forward to work together. We'll get in touch with you as well. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir, in the back.
Assalamu alaikum. I am Siddiqui, President Bangladesh Indenting Agent Association. I think our problem to achieve the SDG is the finance, because the private sector approximately will invest 75% and 25% from the government, public sector. And private sector will invest in education, in health sector, they will improve the working condition, and then at the same time they will look into the environment issue and also increase the employment generation. So private sector require huge amount. At the same time, government will generate fund from the tax. So if you look into the policy of the government, Bangladesh government is focusing on value-added tax to increase the tax generation and also bring the informal sector to the formal sector. So it's a huge stress on the private sector. So much investment also generating more fund for the public investment. But at the same time, Mr. Asif Ibrahim says, the private sector is ready, but we need some fund. So who will fund the private sector and public sector? I am really in fix. I am expecting an answer from the discussion here. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. On the left, yes.
Can you all hear me?
Yeah.
My name is Dr. Hakim. I'm the Managing Director of Engineering Resources International. We're one of the largest environmental engineering companies in Bangladesh. Very good morning to everyone. All the things we've been talking about, I just would like to point out a couple of things very quickly. The main word here is sustainable, right? So in every way, how can we make whatever we have, resources, sustainable, right? That's pretty much the idea. The gap that we have, the big gap in funding to achieve sustainable development goals, a big part of it has to come from elsewhere, okay? As we know, climate change, we're one of the most vulnerable countries. But in this regard, I would like to make a point, which is, when we bring in resources, funds, let's say, from outside, in order to make it sustainable, it is not just good enough to bring in the funds. It is critical for us to build local capacity. And I must say, the foreign organizations and stuff, in as much as it would seem that their intentions are good-willed, local capacity is not really being built, even though that is what it says in everywhere you see. Our goal is to build local capacity, and here is the money and stuff like that. It is not actually being done. Just one last thing. Our company is very much involved hand in hand with this entire sustainability effort, in the sense that Mr. Asif Ibrahim mentioned about the PAC program. We're one of the lead providers for that. We've already worked with about 200 textile mills in saving resources, water, energy, and what have you. Also, we worked with the country provider for SDWI, which is Sweden Textile Water Initiative, and so on and so on. Anyways, but that was my primary point, is that we need funds from abroad, but those funds need to make sure that it creates capacity, local capacity. It's like, you know, you give someone a fish or you teach them fishing. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Hakim. Do you have any other? Yes, sir, in the front.
Captain M.D. Noor Hawk, a member DCCI, a co-convener, and now working. So thank you very much. The good morning to all. The here, I have to ask a question here. The keynote presenter, Mr. Asif, he has presented the papers very nicely. So we can get all the things from here. But my question is here that there are two sectors to develop a country. That is the private sectors and the government sectors. The when the all the things are being done by the private sectors, government sectors are showing some ways. You see, we can say for the Padma Bridge, there is a budget of 40,000 taka. But from here, 40,000, I think crore, 40,000 crore. So here, we have to pay, say, 4,000 crore taka to government. So when we will be doing this work, then here also we have to pay some money to the government. That is the, and the work is being done by the private sectors. See, if government is not showing or giving any facilities to the private sectors, how we can work? Say the electricity we have pointed it out, but the price of the electricity is being how every year. So we hear that the price of the electricity will be high recently also. So then we are facing so many problems. These private sectors are being bogged down to somewhere. So we hope that the government will give some priorities for all these works of the private sectors. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Do we have a, yes, sir.
Thank you very much for this big gathering. My name is Major Yad Ali Fakir, retired. The name of my company is Yad Limited. I am also a member of the DCCI and former director of DCCI. I would like to mention one point here. Back I was invited a seminar on 7 BIMSTEC countries. The subject was multi-sectoral technical and economic cooperation. The involvement of the head of the government, senior government officers, industrialists, industrial association, then trading associations, and the associated chambers, the headquarters is in Bangladesh. I think if we can involve this thing like this head of the government, government senior officers, private sectors, all business magnates, then I think it will help us to take the opinion of there. It will help us to go ahead with this object of this job. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Assalamu alaikum and a very good afternoon. I'm Rubina Hussain. I represent Bangladesh Federation of Women Entrepreneurs and Industry Skills Council for Tourism and Hospitality, and also Zonta International as UN Committee Chairman of four countries. That's Bangladesh, Nepal, Sri Lanka and India. Basically, I'll be speaking on women empowerment and regarding bridging the friendship and building skills, knowledge for Bangladesh, dynamic Bangladesh. I think women's rights are interconnected and indivisible. We need substantive equality and not a formal equality alone. Based on these sustainable goals, which Mr. Asif has already mentioned, giving preference to 8, 9, and 12, we have actually a fixed directive, particularly based on gender equality. That's the Sustainable Goal 5, which entails, of course, education, and the last goal, that is 17, regarding the global partnership and national partnership, which is very, very important. For sustainable goals, we have 17 goals, and it is the priority of each country. Based on the priority sectors important. So it is up to us on national level and individual organizations to take into account each and every goals which you can actually enhance and grow on that. based on the gender equality, because we are working on women empowerment through skills and minimizing unemployment and eradicating poverty, I would like to draw a few pointers, Mr. Nasim Manzur. Several items remain important when it comes to improve women's economic empowerment of women in the changing world of work. We are working with ILO, Bangladesh, and also Asian Development Bank here. And thank you, Bangladesh Employers Federation, also for your support in a very big way. We are working on the skills sector. Regarding the gender employment gap, I would like to point that we are all aware of the rates of women, which is lower than men's employment rate, and the occupational segregation, which is unequal gender distribution across and within occupations, which is widespread, and women's improved educational attainment, which needs to be solved regarding the issue. And also the gender wage gap, data, you know, the Prime Minister at the UN session has already, I think, announced that we are going to give emphasis on gender analysis and gender data, which is very, very important, and she's got an award for that also, I think. It is very, very important that the difficult transition for young women from education to the labor market is there. Although women made significant progress in education, this hasn't translated into comparable improvements in women's position at work. And also the gender gap in hours worked, which tends to work much longer hours per day, mainly in unpaid work, be it RMG sector or the other industries in Bangladesh. So we need to realize that even if we do emphasize on goal 8, 9, and 12, I think goal 4, which is education, in every aspect, in every sector, knowledge is very important. And we need to improve on our information, access to information more than anything else. And the commitment and conviction is the key to progress, because until and unless we have the conviction, we talk a lot, but how much are we actually achieving? So we need to do the talk the walk and walk the talk. And so this is what I was emphasizing on. Regarding the women at work and the skill sector, I feel that if we enhance and give quality skills on competency-based training to emphasize on particular skills which can be placed appropriately in each and every sectors, because the government has already recognized 22 sectors which has come up, and most of us, we are not aware of it. And that access to information needs to be given out to the private sector, and the support of the government is very, very important. Thank you.
Thank you very much. The last speaker is Dr. Moazzam of CPD.
Thank you, Chair. I first like to thank the keynote presenter for his excellent presentation, and after that the discussants also made substantive input in the discussion. I have two, three points regarding SDG implementation by the private sector. In fact, globally, it's a debating issue that how much private sector is ready to compromise their competitiveness against the sustainability issue that has been actually discussed under these SDG goals. It has always been a challenge for the private sector to actually deal with this, to some extent, a different kinds of things in one go. So it's really a challenging part. And most importantly for the countries of Asia, where it is considered to be a manufacturing hub nowadays, are each of the countries are actually competing with each other in the global value chain, in the global market. And that's why the, in terms of the preparedness of the SDG related to the private sector, it is observed that the Asian region is rather behind than other regions in terms of implementation of SDG related in this context. I particularly like to mention about the progress happened in case of the Latin American region and also in to some extent in the African region in terms of SDG implementation, where Asia is considered to be rather behind. So, and this is because the private sector is not fully ready to compromise their competitiveness because of actually implementing these SDG related various kinds of goals. So that's an important thing to look at, that whether private sector is fully ready to do that. The second point is that ultimately the SDG goals are finally being technical, means that all the goals will relate to some of the targets. So what we need finally is to achieve those targets, and we have to go some of the values of this percentage, that percentage, we have to achieve that. So we have to do that exercise at the national level, that how those targets with specific goals is related to the private sector, and how the private sector is ready to achieve that by 2030. So another exercise is needed by the private sector, that in each of the SDG goals that has been mentioned by the keynote presenter, what is the targets and what is the level of achievement they are actually aspire to by 2030. That also is very important. My last point is that SDG is to some extent actually giving the targets at a national level, more like an horizontal approach. But as the private sector is gradually becoming a global partner of the global value chain, then there is a vertical integration in the global production system. So if a country like Bangladesh is making its domestic level compliant, but the sourcing countries of raw materials and others are being non-compliant, then it rather being a disproportionate development of SDG. So it is also important in both horizontal and vertical level that other competing countries are ready to comply with implementing the SDG targets. So that is another part. And finally, what I like to mention is that we can get various good examples that we heard this morning, and those are very much well appreciated. But finally, we have to keep in mind that we have to end with a summing up with the results that both signed will come to achieving the SDG goals. Otherwise, that we may find some good examples, but that the sum up of all those goals may not add the required level. So we have to find out that solution, that all the good examples and good initiatives by various sectors have to comply with the targets and the technical standards that has been fixed up by the SDGs. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I have a request for 2 minutes from Dr. Bhattacharya. You can decide.
We are not mutually exclusive, so after having spoken, Dr. Debapriya is most welcome to give his comment. No, I'd like to join all others, and as member of the core committee, I'd like to also register our deep appreciation of this partnership with the MCCI this morning, and as host of the citizens platform, particularly very happy. I would like to take on what Dr. Muazzam has just mentioned, which is very important. And if we look at it from a point of compromising competitiveness, then obviously we will not be able to attain the SDG goals. What is meant here is that private sector has to be a part of the implementation of the SDGs. And if we recall, the Global Compact is a combination of 8,000 enterprises. They were a central element in terms of designing the SDGs. So private sector has been part of the design of the SDGs from the very beginning, unlike the MDGs. So that is very important that private sector considers that it is. And also, we have to also remember that it is also good business to be environmentally sustainable and socially inclusive. And it has to be horizontally and vertically, it has to be implemented. If some organizations and some private sector enterprises, they implement and others don't implement, and they get away with lower prices, then obviously
it will be, you know, it will be compromised. But the idea is that we'll have to see that it is implemented. And the second is, how do we monitor that it is implemented? Now that SDGs also talk about data revolution, and unfortunately, private sector data, we have a lot of weaknesses over there. So I think that in order to monitor the implementation of those goals and targets which Asif has mentioned, and our discussions have also broadened, if we can have a menu of the targets where the private sector is involved and the indicators are already there, so if we can then generate the data and monitor, then we can see the progress and where are the difficulties. And the last point that I will make is that, you see, there are and the global policy initiatives which are needed in order to enable our countries to implement the SDGs and also the private sector. For example, just one example, environmental goods and services. Now, if we don't have access to those goods and services, obviously, of the private sector to implement the SDGs in an environmentally and socially inclusive manner will be difficult. So I think those policy coherence in the WTO, in WIPO, that also we'll have to hammer. I think so at three levels, private sector on its own, private sector vis-a-vis the public sector, and it was very good that it is not just a partnership but also planning, and private sector vis-a-vis global institutions. I think all three levels we'll have to hammer so that that we really mean business. Thank you.
I want to be inclusive, so is Dr. Bhattacharya going to speak now? Or Ms. Anam was going to speak.
Thank you. The partnership, the fact that it took me an hour to find this building, I was thinking how far apart we are for it. No, I have not. So, but thank you. I'm absolutely delighted to be here, even though if it is the first time. And I just want to make a few points about collaboration. I think there is not enough understanding of what we do as civil society organizations and what the private sector does overall. And there is a kind of, you're certainly not the bad guys anymore. Sometimes I feel we are the bad guys now. But there is certainly a misunderstanding or lack of understanding overall of what the civil society NGO sector does and the private sector does. I think there is a need to come together, and this is a great opportunity for us to do that. There's very little time, but I would just say that we work to build an inclusive society, not only inclusive growth, which an inclusive society which encompasses everything in all its dimension. The SDG goal, whether you talk about health, women's rights, education, whatever, all comes together in goal 16, where I know Debapriya is going to talk elaborately on that and so much more eloquently. I'll just say that nothing will work if we don't have strong, accountable, transparent institutions, and that is where we have to put our emphasis on. The NGO, the civil society organizations, it's apart from all the other work it does on education, on health, on other issues, skill building, but it is building the confidence and the citizenship rights of people to demand better governance. That is where we all have to come together on one plane, because unless the SDG is owned by the citizens of this country, it will never be attained. So let us put our emphasis there at how do we make the SDG goals inclusive so that each and every person in this country believes that this is my goal and it is the stake is mine, and I need to implement it, and I need to feel that together we will implement. The government, when a government signs on something, it signs on behalf of the people of this country. So certainly the people have a right to question, to look at its implementation, to see where the fund is going, how it is being implemented, and to get some answers. I'll just stop here. Thank you.
Thank you. I think now that Shainapa has spoken and my boss who writes my paycheck, Professor Mustafiz, has spoken, I can now come in.
So I think it was a fantastic discussion, and I'm really, really pleased that we had this discussion at various levels, on the policy levels at the top and going down to the very concrete examples of what is happening in the country, and also looking forward to what may be done in the future. I'm happy that a couple of issues have been taken care of already. One of the issues is the data issue. Mustafa referred to that. I think everybody refers to that. I think if we have to prioritize, there are two areas where we have to get our data right. One is definitely employment. Employment data is, I mean, miserably lacking. This is number one. And number two, we are having a lot of debates now with the Planning Commission and others regarding the investment data, because the private investment has been stagnating, if not fallen, as a percentage of GDP. The informal sector investment data, because the and the discussion is that even if the formal sector is not investing, the informal sector continues to invest. So investment data in the informal sector and the employment data in general, these are the two areas where I think that we need to prioritize our data issues. Musabi has spoken about the systemic issues. I will not go there. Number two issue. No one is to be left behind. If that motto is to be implemented in the case of private sector, then small and medium enterprise industries must get priority. This is a house where possibly these business leaders really do not necessarily represent the small and medium enterprises, but that partnership through MCCI and other bodies, and also FBCCI, we will have to build. So MCCI, small and medium enterprises have to be brought on board. Third, there was this very good issue of the R&D expenditures and the fiscal rebates and etc. In fact, there was an R&D expenditure in the 90s. And there was also tax rebates for private donations to foundations. These two were stopped in the second half of the 90s on the ground, which was made by the late lamented finance minister, that it is being, these are being abused. And that's why it was stopped. No, you do not throw away the baby with the bathwater. You need to, you don't cut off your head because there is a head pain. I think there is a strong reason for doing that, and also from the SDG point of view. If you see at 11.4.1, sorry for this jargon, the target is you will have to make an estimate of private donations made not only on philanthropic or R&D and others, but also on cultural issues and other things. So we will have to do that estimate. And how do you do that estimate without bringing those measures into the fiscal fold? Only through a fiscal assessment mechanism you can really do that particularly. So there is a strong case for this. The finance, the state minister of finance is sitting here. We should argue for it, that the investment made in research and development and also in other philanthropic and other activities has to be estimated and accounted for and rewarded. So that is the, my last point is that everybody mentioned about resources and finances, and Mr. Siddiqui, yes, there you are. And you thought, and many others, there is an assumption that it will be done by foreign money. I'm sorry, this is not correct. If you look at our estimates, or MDG, 82% of all the investment on MDGs were done by the government. It is the national government who have done all the expenditures at the end of the day. So it is, again, in the future, we are not really going around with begging bowls. We'll have to get our tax GDP ratio right and get hold of all the harmonizations and etc. as it goes. So this is a clear case on that. So the foreign finances are necessary. They are complementary. They are catalytic. They are strategic interventions. But no, I will finish by saying only one thing. Nasim, through you, I put forward to everybody that because of this discussion and all the institutional arrangement which has been talked about, and Ms. Pant has also referred to that, I make the plea, based on today's discussion, it should not be just an event. It has to be a process. So my whole point is today, based on all the discussion you had, from the citizens platform, we'll be very happy to collaborate with MCCI, with FBCCI, to prepare a document for the government. Pathways, private sector pathways towards implementing SDGs. A private sector pathways towards implementing SDGs. That's my proposal to MCCI, and the citizens platform remains ready, including Mustafiz and his team at CPD to partner in this particular way, so that we have a consolidation of that and a follow-up mechanism for that. Thank you for giving me the time.
Thank you very much, Dr. Bhattacharya. I think we will now move on to the last part of our program. I'd like to now first request our special guest, of course, the Senior Vice President of the FBCCI, past President of BGME, and of course, an established leader on his own, Mr. Mohammed Shafiul Islam, to kindly make his remarks. About 10 minutes, sir, if possible.
Less than 10 minutes would be okay. But you have suggested a very good point that I should not address anybody.
Yes.
So this is our culture. So, chief guest, Mr. Mannan, MP, Honorable State Minister
sir,
for Finance.
Can skip it.
Can I skip it?
We can skip it, sir.
Anyway, I must thank Asif Ibrahim for his wonderful presentation. And Nasim Manzur is moderating very well. I must give a thanks. So in this way, all are coming. So, and Mr. Debapriya is always speaking well. Anyway, distinguished discussant, distinguished business leader from chambers and associations and MCCI, members of the media, ladies and gentlemen, good afternoon by this time, I think. It is my pleasure to be here today and learn so many things from the, you know, very experienced and academia and business leaders. They have shared their experience, and especially how do we be able to achieve the SDG through partnering different groups like citizen platforms, MCCI, and Bangladesh government and private sector. So things is, we have, you know, country, it's 160 million people, it's a very small piece of land, but you know, the way we have achieved MDG, that is our inspiration, I should say. But after MDG, it is a, we are turning into achieving SDG. It's a big, big challenge, because in this moment, engagement of private sector and relying, economy is relying on private sector highly today, and less dependency on donor partner and aid. It's a private sector-led and export-led growth Bangladesh is having, agriculture, and thanks to the migrant workers, those who are contributing to the economy. But if we consider the world economy and the world political situation, it's not easy. These are all external factors, like, you know, Middle Eastern problem, Brexit, and TPP, on many, many things, and the American two leaders, the way we are seeing the, you know, like a monkey type of election. So this has been the old culture of Bangladesh. We used to blame each other, and that has been exported to them now. like our limited resources, we are very experienced to manage the disaster management. We are becoming an authority with our limited resources, and the way we are managing the terrorism today. So we have many achievements, especially the private from private sector. We must claim that as to elevation of poverty, reduction of and women empowerment to every goals. Today we are saying that all the private sector is always a huge contribution is there. So today I'm talking about some negative things, like, you know, the port. We have two ports. We are highly reliant on Chittagong port. Last 7-8 days we have been struggling. But this port used to handle $2 billion. Now we are handling $35 billion export. Forget about the import. So this is the situation. This should be uninterrupted. So unfortunately, if we give our whole heart and effort, we cannot make it, we cannot achieve it. Somehow we manage to defer that situation till fourth. This is the situation we got to be remembered. Here our honorable chief guest is here. I'm drawing his attention in this sector. And our MCCI leader is one of the, you know, innovative businessman in leather sector. He is the authority, but unfortunately he has to import leather, though we have a lot of leather. Because of the compliance issue, we could not explore that sector. Still, we are highly reliant on garment sector. This is not a good way. We want to see the diversification of product. Honorable chief guest, we always, you know, having an interactive meeting before the budget, but we don't see the right reflection in the budget of our views. Is not taking into consideration. We would like to draw the attention that you will. Because our Prime Minister is one. When we have a problem, we are going to her to solve the problem. Is it possible for a person? We have some people in between, those who are helping and cooperating the sector to make it a smooth, ensure the smooth journey of the sector. We have seen so many of the government official and the ministers, but many of them are inefficient. They should not be there.
No names.
It is not necessary to name. Is to have whom it may concern. Gas prices. I'm just giving you a few examples. Like, you know, I started with the port situation in Dhaka Airport. If you go, you will see that our goods are lying there, and you know, under rain and any kind of problem, there is no shed, and the goods are always pilfered from there. There is a syndication there. Believe me, Honorable Prime Minister has stepped into this matter, and he engaged our Principal Secretary, and he is a very able person. He has taken initiative. He called all the secretaries to the port, and they came, and one by one, why did you take so long? Minimum 7 days. Why people are bringing goods, importing goods through a costly mode of transportation? Is air freight is a huge matter. Because of the urgency, we don't have the raw material. Most of the cases we have to import from abroad. In this case, he has taken initiative in last, you know, fasting months. He's kind enough to go there and asking people to solve this problem. Many people raises many points that we have lack of, you know, manpower, lack of computer, this, that. Then immediately BGMA president said how many, you know, data entry operator you need. And principal secretary said, okay, BGMA will provide 15 BGMA data entry operator. And he has, you know, immediately sent the resume of the 15 people, but two has been employed in an ad hoc basis. They are in under tremendous pressure to kick them out from there. So this is the situation. It's not so easy, you know, if the political will of the Honorable Prime Minister is always there, she is helping. And when just we back from the United Nations, and we have seen the world, the way she has been praised, you know, for the development of Bangladesh. It's a remarkable. After, despite all these challenges, Bangladesh is growing. There's no doubt about it. I'm always optimistic. I believe there's no, it's an unstoppable country. Despite of all these limitations and problems, this country is going forward. And many of the things is here in the SDG, but main thing is access to the finance. You need finance for women empowerment, health, poverty elevation, wherever you say. I'm again sharing one or two practical things with you. Our Honorable Prime Minister has a dream to give a dormitory to the workers. Real living conditions. 1% interest. Believe me, last 10 years we have been going to the central bank and coming and going and having meeting, but nothing happening. Last, finally, me and Dhaka City Mayor Anisil has qualified for getting that loan, to making a dormitory. Then finally they said, you need to sign, your spouse need to sign the, you know, in the mortgage. I don't know why. So this is the situation we have been handling every day. This is the reality of the country. And also, if you see, we don't have the raw material in this country. Most of the cases, if you say leather, we have raw leather, but we don't have the finished leather here. And he has to, you know, satisfy his customer. That's why he has to import from Italy or other parts of the world. And for compliance issue, we have to create a, we have designated one zone in Hamirpur, but actually the ETP has been set. It is not the international level. So that has to be pinpointed and look at and take care of all these problems we have in this moment. And energy is a huge, huge problem for us, thanks to the government, and already they have been able to produce more than 14,000 megawatts of electricity, and now they're looking at distribution, transmission, and some stations. So it is going very well, and we hope that it will be okay within. I totally, you know, believe that in long-term plan, government has a very good vision. But in short-term and mid-term, we have to be very specific how we're going to negotiate all these matters. So this is how it is, you know, if we talk about already Mr. Manzur has confined me within 10 minutes, so I don't want to prolong that. So things is that this country has the history. In any situation, the resilience of the private sector is there. We are engaged, but we need to, you know, we'll ask the government to take into consideration, especially what India is doing today for boosting the export. So lot of incentive. We have sent recently a group of people after the Prime Minister Modi has visited, he invited us to invest there. You know, 6.5 rupee for the exporter, the electrical per unit price. And they're asking 40 acres of land for 25 crore rupee in Gujarat. And he said, Mr. Manzur was with us, he said private land is a, you know, no control of the central government, but local government can give you. But he said, if you come to Gujarat, sky is the limit. So thing says, our government is really keen to see the special economic zone, but we want to see that landing in time, so that we can go to a planned area where all the facilities will be there, environmental friendly industry and dormitory, hospitals, health, all the SDG conditions we can meet there. And these are, and thanks to the organizer, those who has organized these timely, you know, sessions. And from FBCCI, we can assure you we will be always engaged. We have been engaging with the government. Finally, if we don't, you know, get any answer, even she was in Washington, we called her to, you know, solve the problem of the Chittagong port, and immediately she responded. Things is that that political will has to be disseminated, and we want to see the execution, those who has got the responsibility to execute. I hope that we'll be able to achieve the goals of SDG before 2030. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Mr. Shafiul Islam Mohiuddin, for, as usual, extremely thought-provoking and I think a very realistic summary of where we stand in business today. It is now my distinct honor and pleasure to introduce and request our chief guest, Mr. Abdul Mannan MP, the Honorable Minister of State for Finance Planning, to make his remarks. Sir.
Thank you, Chair. Let me begin by apologizing. I'm wearing dark glasses, but I mean no harm. Because of very strong medical reasons, I can't really stand glares. It's a limitation. I can't read close also. Mr. Mohiuddin was mentioning government sees far but doesn't see near. At this moment, I can see nothing near, but I can see far. I'm really in the government. And I hope I am not in the texting list of Mr. Mohiuddin. You X some people. I hope I'm not in that list. Thank
of
you.
Of course, you are.
It's once again a great honor to be in MCCI, our venerable chair body. I've been here about 3-4 times before. It's always a great pleasure. It's very well organized, and our young president, Nasim Manzur, he doesn't need any sort of appreciation, but I think he's doing a good job. That is also sitting on my right, Asif, sitting on my left, Asif, and here, Nasim, and beyond, Shahzad, our new, what I would say, our next generation, who are taking and who are moving in, and we of the old time, we feel encouraged that it's in good hands. I would like to begin by once again appreciating your very elaborate presentation. I'm sorry I could not read this at home, although it was sent to me. I had a very quick look. I could see you put in a lot of labor. You worked very hard. Being in business, I was wondering how you could get so much time to really develop this very well-organized paper. I thank you for that. Most of the points you raised, I have no quarrel with those. They're very familiar points. We all know it from our positions now. It's very quite familiar. One or two I'll have to sit with you and maybe later and have some discussions. Particularly, you said something about mixed governance. Being in the government, so the word sort of jarred me. Mixed governance, what does it mean? Governance, the way we see that there is an elected government which is run on the constitutional line. So mixed governance is something new to me. So I would talk with you later, but I want to learn from that. Then you had a very strong point about research and development and technologies. You said you wanted everything homegrown. Everything homegrown you wanted, which is a great thing. But I think the times have changed. As you say, that there is no need to reinvent the wheel. There are a lot of technologies which would be waste to be really sort of not borrowing and not buying and not using or stealing even. There is no sense sort of work doing research in everything. So we need research, very important, but we have to find out the areas where we need the research, the niches where we have a special competitive edge. Otherwise, it would be total waste to be doing something which the others have already gone beyond by millions of miles, and we can't catch up with them. That's the reality. And being in the shared one world, there is no sense quarreling with those. So that's one point I would like to bring up again. Apart from saying that this is a very good paper, and of course we'll keep it in our mind. One or two other things, Dulal, Abdusita Dulal, Mr. Dulal, raised a very strong point about the rights and privileges and facilities for the disabled people. Disability matter. It's very important. You know, our Prime Minister is very interested in almost everything that I have seen. There is nothing in this country, there is nothing here, no subject on which she has not a very strong stand. She's a very committed person. About disability also, I have seen working quite near her that she is absolutely committed to that. And I think she has done some good work. We have done some good work. Not enough, we need to do more. Like in the latest economic decisions, whenever construction matters come, she always says, what are you doing for the disabled people? Do you have the ramp? Do you have special toilet facilities? Exactly, I'm telling you from hearing from her and our PWD and other departments who are in the construction job, they're keeping it in mind. So this is one point, but we need to do more. And even the rural schools now, primary schools in the villages, I've been visiting sometimes, my constituency, I've seen ramps are being provided for children. Although some people question, we have no disabled people here, why do it here? But it's a different matter. The point is recognized and taken care of. I hope we can build more on that, but it's a very important point. My God. This question of infrastructure, well, this is very well known. Our infrastructure is weak, our infrastructure is insufficient. We are building, we have to build much more, and we are borrowing a lot of money from abroad. We are raising money from inside. We have a very huge, huge program. Chinese president is coming next week, I think, and with a big baggage of more loans. And here I have a word for that. Mr. Ibrahim mentioned 3-4 times, donors. I would humbly request that we drop out this word. We never had donors in the sense that Mr. Debapriya would say. But we don't have. Why do we have to use this word? You know, it's because of the initial years of independence when there were UNRIG, who were supporting a lot of people. UNROD or something. That still is in our mind. In my Ministry of Finance, where I work, our bureaucrats always write about donors. I say, why do we use this word? Our present budget, not even 1% is donor money. Dr. Debapriya Bhattacharya said, MDGs, on which we scored very well, 80% he said of money was spent by us, by our people. So what is the donor business here? So we of course appreciate help, we need guidance, we appreciate friends, but I don't think we have to depend on that word. And then again, the question of about data, yes, it's very important, but again, I can tell you our data was very, very weak initially. We are building a very strong BBS now. Bangladesh Bureau of Statistics is working quite well. Its quality is improving, as some people have said, with support and help from other agencies, also global agencies, not donors. And then again, from our universities, we are taking help from Dhaka University, from Shah Jalal, Jil Silat. And we can assure you that this department will continue to grow and be more accurate. But of course, we agree that there are a lot of ground to be covered here. Then again, the question of women's and gender, wage gap, etc. you raised. I think about women also we have done fairly well. We are carrying a heritage of what I would say gender inequality in this country. This is built in our culture. Even despite all that we have done, there are areas which is still beyond our reach. But again, we would say that since we are in the right direction, all we need is the sustained efforts in this line, so that we can reach the point where our men and women, this gender sort of inequality will be completely eradicated and justice will be given. We don't want to favor women, we don't want to favor men. We want them to work within their own areas with full rights. That is what we are looking for. Mid-level management, Mr. Manzur said, is very important. Yes, I agree with you. We are putting in a lot of efforts at the lower level. The government is putting a lot of money in the skill development, which is at a lower level. But yes, we carry this message, and we'll, with your support, I hope we can continue our talk on that. About institutional building, follow-up also you mentioned, yes, that we are very weak on that. We don't have institutions which are really, what I would say, solid, which has a history of, working for long. That what they say, institutional memory is very short here. Memory not in the mind, but in the system itself. That is still very weak, but we hope we have to do more on that, and we'll work with you. Dialogue with the private sector, dialogue with you who are in the driving seat now, 80% of the businesses and finances in your head, that's obvious. But yes, we have dialogue almost every few days, like here today, we're sitting with you and talking, but we can't say that we have structured, we have a systemic dialogue is not there. Probably there is a part of our culture. We don't do things in a systematic way. And here also we lack that. So we are prepared to sit and work with you longer. Our Prime Minister is open. Our Finance Minister is of course open. I as a junior minister can assure you that we want to always continue the dialogue with you. And if you come with a proposal to build up a mechanism through which we can continue it, like NBR and the BCCI recently have started a work on that. I can assure you that from my level, if I am the ministry, I will continue to work with you on that score. There is a question of urbanization. Well, I don't need to touch that. In my mind, I think this Bangladesh is becoming one village city or city village. I won't be here, of course, sure. 20 years from now, probably these corridors will all link up. Dhaka Chittagong corridor, Dhaka Sirat corridor, with small cities in between, small towns in between. This will become one large mega village or one large village city, global, of about 200 million people, 200 million people or 25 million people, 30 million people. If we have enough power, enough infrastructure, link up this small country can become one large mega village. That is where I think, it's my vision, I think we are working on that light. About VAT, someone raised about VAT. From there, I would like to once again appeal that on VAT, we need your help and support. We have failed to implement it two times. There is a question of credibility on your side, on our side also. It's a good thing you have all agreed on various discussions. It's good because not only we are doing it, many other countries are doing it now and they are successful. So this is one area we would like to collaborate, and we'll be with FBCCI and MCCI and other trade bodies so that this year in 17 at least we are able to implement it and go on the field on the VAT thing. The question of NGO CSO activities, Shahina probably mentioned that, yes, I'll be very frank. We know it's a huge area of activity. There are a lot of good people working on that and very good things. But there is sort of a shortage of, I'm being very frank and open with you, because I do hear from my side, I was in the NGO world myself. I was DG NGO for 3 years. So I had some opportunity to see the work inside. What is lacking is that, yes, someone comes and says, I'm an NGO, I'm working on water. I ask, okay, what are you doing on water? How many tubes you have sunk? Where? How many people are drinking water out of the pots you have given? I don't give a specific answer. Someone else comes and says, I work with women. I'm an NGO, I work with women. Yes, good sir, thank you very much. What do you do with women? I don't get a specific answer. Someone else comes and says, our work is on children and, you know, this and that and mothers. I say, very good, how? Tell me how many children you have fed, how many schools you've opened for the women, how many schools you've opened for the children. I don't get a specific answer. Not some, I'm saying generally. So there is a lack of, you know, there is a lack of information here. We don't know what most of the NGOs do in the field, apart from the fact that we know they are there. We know they are spending a lot of money by our standards, but we don't know what they do at the end of the day. That is my experience being in the NGO bureau myself for 3 years almost, and being in the government now, because I do hear my colleagues and other senior bureaucrats also talk about this matter sometimes in our cabinet meetings and in various meetings. We are a little concerned on that. We would like to know more about NGO activity, but let me again be very, very honest about it. We do respect their good work, we do respect, and they have a right to work in the way they like, but since it is some kind of cash flowing in there, some kind of new ideas coming in there, we would like to know where it is going and how it is functioning. So, Mr. Anam, please, if you would not mind my commenting on that. Yeah, sure, we'll sit up. No, always. Not now, no, not now. We can continue the dialogue here also. Yes, of course. So I think I should be coming to the end of my talking about the matters. I would like to once again assure you all, assure everyone here.
Incentives and subsidies.
Incentives, subsidies, various rates and export processing zones, and yeah, there is no end to it. But this road must end somewhere. This can't go on and on and on. In my layman's idea, I'm being very blunt here, quote unquote, at this level of economic development, at this level of total national output, this country is one of the most welfare state in the world for a very few number of people. Total population 160 million, for about 2 to 3 million, this country is paradise in the world. Number one welfare state in the world. This is my unresearched, unread, on hand, working in the field comment. Please excuse me, this is off the record. So, why you're mentioning about subsidies, you're mentioning about incentives, yes, we must provide, but there is a cost to that also. Dr. Bhattacharya is here, Mustafa Sahib is here. If you want to say whether our economy, how long it can take this cost, that accounting must be done at the same time. So this is an area in which I probably can't talk for long, but it's from gut feeling. I feel this road must come to an end very soon. If we have to achieve justice, if we have to achieve fairness for everyone in this country, for the millions who lie beyond our hand at this moment, for the millions for whom we cannot provide gas and power at the rate at which we use here in Metropolitan Dhaka. So these are national issues. I just raise it for discussing within the doors. I don't want this to be, please, if you mind, media, kindly avoid this part of my statement when I say it. I could have to say my neck also. At the end of the day, at the end of the day. So anyway, I may move into politics, a dangerous thing. I am attracted by politics. If I could talk to the villagers, I could talk on for hours and talk about the matters. But this is a very limited circle here. I don't want to talk about the matters. Thank you. Now, I can once again say what I feel being in the government for 3 years now almost, and being in the government at the other end for 30 years before this, in the bureaucracy, working in the rural areas, working in national secretariat, working in various divisions and district offices. I have seen some, at least two, three governments, including two military governments, pass through. This government has, there has never been a government in this country which has been more open to the public. This is my reading. This is the way I see it. Now, you agree or not, that's your personal, but what I'm saying, this is open. Why? Because the way the people are reacting to this government, that's how I see. The way the people are coming to the government for Jongi control, for Girao control, for Hartal control, the last 4 or 5 years have been the best period of our last 30, 35 years. People have not responded to any anarchy, people have not responded to any misconduct on the roads, on the rivers, anywhere. That is what makes me think Sheikh Hasina and her government has been able to deliver, has been able to reach to the heart of the people because they are not responding to the alternative wrong ways. So that is how I make the judgment. I would like to thank MCCI again for being so kind. They keep on request, they keep on asking me to meet them. It's always a pleasure. And I would again, to many of you whom I have met here today and met before also, I would once again like to pay my respect and thank you for this opportunity. Asif Manzur, thank you once again for this kindness. Thank you. Jai Bangla.
Thank you very much, sir, for once again, I think a very frank and forceful conclusion. It is my job now as the chair to sum up a little bit our discussions. I think the starting point for the summation would be that 10 out of the 17 goals in the SDG have the word sustainable in them. And the question, of course, becomes then, as we've already heard, where does the finance come from? And I completely agree with our Honorable State Minister on this, that looking outside on for donors is not the solution. 82%, as has been correctly stated by Dr. Bhattacharya, of the MDG spending has been internally generated. However, I would also like to put on record, and I'd like to thank my friend Shehzad for mentioning this, that business needs to be sustained before it can be sustainable. And I think there are certain misconceptions out there in the media and the public domain that profit is not necessarily a dirty word. It is possible to be ethical and operate within the laws of the land and still be profitable. It is the duty of corporations to earn profit and create value for our shareholders and therefore society as large, as long as we do it within the dictates and the rules of society. I would like to thank Dr. Mohsen for a very important point, which I was hoping would come out, where we have to be careful that when we look at sustainability, how that, the paradox that we're talking about vis-a-vis competitiveness. I personally, this is my personal view, not as MCCI, my personal view as a person who works in business, that some of the goals that are stated are a direct threat to competitiveness to Bangladesh and are not appropriate to this stage of development. This is a personal view. So we need to be clear on how we set those goals, how do we prioritize, how do we decide what the priorities are. As we've already heard, the importance of data, that if Bangladesh is going to set its own priorities, which goals are first, which goals are second, you need to do this on the basis of data, and data is lacking, so can we create the resources for that? Since resources are limited, we need to generate our own resource and allocate, we need to decide how. The importance of an enabling environment, whether it is taxation on technical know-how fees, or urban land usage programs, VAT that you talked about, extremely important. The importance of quality public sector procurement, once again, very, very important. We see a lot of spending. What is the quality of the spending? What is the outcome of this spending? The need for dialogue. I want to thank Dr. Debapriya. I think he used the words sporadic dialogue and no lack of follow-up and thematic dialogue. And, you know, it's almost like knee-jerk. There needs to be a system in place where dialogue is continuous and dialogue is followed up, as was mentioned by BCCI, by outcomes that are reflected in things like the budget, but also in things like the industrial policy. So we don't see enough of that at the moment. The point about Dhaka. Dhaka is the 10th most populous city in the world. It is one of the three, unfortunately, most unlivable cities of the world. It is also 50%, if I'm not mistaken, of our GDP. We cannot fix Bangladesh if we don't fix Dhaka. I think the old ideas, some of them a little romantic, if I can say, of creating multiple Dhakas are not going to be valid. It's not going to happen. You look at Korea. Korea grew out of two cities, Seoul and Busan. So you have to have poles of growth. Dhaka and Chittagong are poles of growth. And you need to expand Dhaka, you need to expand Chittagong. And you need to make Dhaka better so that investment will come. Otherwise, investments will not come. Investments will flow out of Bangladesh. We talked about the point of leaving no one behind, right? The core philosophy behind SDGs, whether that is the physically challenged, whether that is women, whether that are SMEs. Once again, the decision that, of course, has to be done by the government, but we hope in consultation with the private sector. We at the MCCI, and if I speak also for FBCCI, Dhaka Chamber, BUILD, all of us are ready here to participate in that process and to build ultimately, as was mentioned by our fellow member of the Citizens Platform, institutions in Bangladesh. Because then at the end of the day, as was pointed out by Mr. Mohiuddin, we need institutions to take us forward. The political will genuinely is there. We can see that. Execution on the ground leaves a lot to be desired. And we hope through outcomes like this, this will improve. With those words, I would like to conclude. Thank each and every one of you for being here, and especially thank our key presenter, Mr. Asif Ibrahim, for an excellent session. Thank you very much. Please join us for lunch. Thank you. Lunch is served in the next room. Please join us. 1 o'clock.